A friend of mine came over to see me, and I was confined to bed. I couldn't move. But as she left, she said, "Shall I put a record on?" And I said, "Please." And she put a record on and then left. The record was much too quiet, but I couldn't reach to turn it up. And it was raining outside, so it was a record of 18th century harp music, I remember. And so I lay there at first kind of frustrated by this situation, but then I started listening to the rain and listening to these odd notes of the harp that were just loud enough to be heard above the rain. And this was a great musical experience for me, and I suddenly thought of this idea of making music that didn't impose itself on your space in the same way, but created a sort of landscape that you could belong to, you could be part of.
That was from an interview with Brian Eno, a world-renowned English musician and record producer that is credited with inventing the title of the genre that we'll be discussing. Today, I want to talk a little bit about the history of this unique, subtle, and very fascinating kind of sound. This is an introduction to ambient music. First things first, it's important to note that this entire genre is based on a lack of conventional musical structure. It's not about creating catchy hooks and melodies, there's not any repeated choruses. It's instrumental music emphasized on creating a mood, a feeling, a certain atmosphere. Something I find particularly interesting about this genre is that the listening experience is unlike anything I've ever felt before. It's a bit paradoxical in the sense that it feels both complex and also incredibly stripped down. Ambient music is something that you could fall asleep to, or you could grab your best headphones and try to study every note. As the great Brian Eno once said, ambient music must be able to accommodate many levels of listening attention without enforcing one in particular. It must be as ignorable as it is interesting. Isn't that wonderful? It must be as ignorable as it is interesting. If that doesn't intrigue you, I don't know what will. Before Brian Eno came along, a vague idea of mood-setting music had already been around for about a century. There was a French composer named Eric Satie that coined the phrase furniture music, which pretty much meant music that you could play during dinner, for instance. It would go along well within the atmosphere of that event. It would be complementary to everything else that was going on. The music was not the main focus, but it would blend seamlessly into the environment, sort of like furniture. So although Satie was probably creating the earliest forms of ambient music in the late 1800s, his idea of the genre was mainly just utilizing a piano. His composition certainly had some of the common tropes of modern ambient music, but we need to fast forward to the 1960s to see this genre start to really take shape. Around this time, musicians were experimenting all over the place, with unusual ideas and strange motivations for why they were making their art. This wave of experimentation led to albums like Music for Zen Meditation by Tony Scott and Soothing Sounds for Baby by Raymond Scott. While they weren't necessarily called ambient at the time because the genre didn't exist yet, it became clear later on that these albums definitely fit into the genre. They were instrumental albums, different soundscapes created to fulfill distinct purposes. Music for Zen Meditation was, well, Music for Zen Meditation, and Soothing Sounds for Baby was, well, you get it. P.S. If you can't already tell, ambient musicians tend to be very literal and straightforward when naming their albums. As the genre progressed into the 1970s, it finally started gaining a signature sound, which all revolved around the frequent and prevalent use of synthesizers. With the godfather of ambient music, Brian Eno, beginning his illustrious career during this time, it's important to take a look at some of his main influences. Scholars and writers of ambient music tend to trace its sonic roots to various electronic and synth-based music from around the world. Mainly, we can look at German and Japanese electronic composers of the late 60s and early 70s, and then Jamaican dub music, which is more or less electronic reggae. So with Brian Eno working hard, producing for a ton of different musicians during this time, the main thing that kept coming back to him was this idea of soundscapes that could create a specific atmosphere. In 1978, he released Ambient 1, Music for Airports, which is pretty much the Illmatic or Sgt. Pepper's of ambient music. just absolutely genre-defining, unbelievably influential, and still just as enjoyable today as the day it came out. The album is 4 tracks long, 48 minutes in length, and truly one of the most interesting albums I've ever heard. Like I said before, ambient projects often have very literal names, and this was music meant to be played in airports. Eno was always stressed and anxious in between flights, and he wanted to make music that would improve those scenarios. And P.S., this is the first time ambient music was called ambient music. Eno was quoted as saying that other people had made this style of music before, but I just gave it a name, which is exactly what it needed. By naming something, you create a difference. You say that this is now real. Names are very important. And from then on out, ambient music became a genre that people contributed to and took seriously. The 80s saw ambient music clashing with the concept of sampling, the 90s saw ambient musicians gain real commercial success and popularity with bands like Orb and the incomparable Aphex Twin. The 2000s saw a rise in more nature-centric soundscapes, and in the 2010s we have the lo-fi anime hip-hop beats to study to, which is a meme at this point, sure, but it also 100% deserves to be mentioned here. There's ambient pop, ambient techno, dark ambient, and a whole world of stuff to discover. I highly recommend you check out this genre, even if you might be skeptical about such a lack of structure, and I hope this was a decent introduction for you. Thanks for watching. Hey, thank you for watching that video. I hope you learned a thing or two. If you want to support the channel, feel free to like, comment, and subscribe. You can follow me on social media at RenshawHS. You can buy my merch, support my Patreon, and thank you so much. I'll see you soon.